We begin and spend the hour tonight with Morley Safer, the co-editor of 60 Minutes. In his 31st year, he's 69. You joined them when you were a kid.
A baby.
You were 38 years old.
38 years old. Mike was probably about 75 then.
Do you feel like the young man around there, or are you the interim guy? I'm not the young man. No, well, you've got Croft.
We have Croft and Leslie Stahl and Ed Bradley, who are mere children.
So you're the middle guy.
But I'm I think the average age on the broadcast, if you count Don Hewitt in the mix.
Well, we have to count
And Phil Schaeffler, who's the senior producer, is around 65.
Social Security show.
Oh, totally.
Everyone asks this, so we'll ask your opinion. The reason for its enduring.
I think the reason for its endurance is quite simply, from the beginning, we always went the extra mile on a story. We did not mess around with the bells and whistles and goofy stuff that often happens in magazines, other magazines, which will go named. We only rarely went for the what might be called the cheap shot. We have made mistakes over the years, for sure. But generally speaking, I think people could turn to us in much the same way as when you and I were much younger, we would turn to Life magazine at something that came through the mailbox once a week. It was a little station of the week. And I think that's what happened with
us. And the public also allows you coverage of international stories, which they don't allow other magazines. I mean, you can go and do a story on somebody in Peru.
And all of the correspondents do on quite a regular basis. And I've heard other magazines say, oh, you guys can get away with that. And I don't know what they mean by that.
Well, I think somebody said it's you're on Sunday night. You're in a unique niche there at 7 o'clock. It's a place we'll accept. Sunday night is different than Tuesday or Wednesday night.
Is it? You really think it is?
I don't know.
We're on Sunday night because that's where they put us 30-odd years ago. I don't think anyone was looking for a particularly special niche or anything like that. I think we became a habit, which is...
That's what you want. You want habit watching.
An interesting phenomenon, but a habit that is much more difficult to break than the habit of, say, watching a sitcom. Sitcoms seem to, I mean, entertainment television seems to have the seeds of death in their life, that they have a run, that an arc that...
In that vein, what do you make of reality television? What do you make of On Your Own Network?
It has nothing to do with reality, as we know.
You don't buy Survivor.
Well, what has it got to do with reality? It is beyond unreality. There's nothing real about it. I've only seen Survivor once, and I understand that on this current edition of Survivor, there are alligators. I am rooting for the alligators. I find it appalling television.
Appalling.
Appalling television.
Because?
This or the other one on Fox or...
Where they're setting up someone to cheat on a mate.
Whatever. it's sleazy, I think, in a certain way. It's manipulative.
Why do so many people watch it?
Because it's sleazy and manipulative.
You're never afraid to sing out what you think. It's your own network, boys.
I know, and I wish we didn't do it. I really do. Indeed, I'm sure it covers us with profit, but not with a lot of pride.
Is it momentary, or will it be around a while?
It's as momentary as anything in popular culture.
So you can't predict it.
I don't think it's going to be around as long as 60 minutes. who knows? I mean, they may... It's the kind of thing where you have to keep upping the ante. And to call it reality, I think, is the world's worst misnomer, and we shouldn't be calling it reality.
Because there are cameras there.
Well, because it has nothing to do with reality. It is a manipulated fantasy. a totally created...
Manipulated situation. We have put people in a manipulated situation. Yeah, here's a classic. We're seeing a little of it now. People in...
I always do that on the weekend, don't I?
For money, we gather with friends and somebody takes home $1 million. Not going to sell Morley. Morley, you were described by Don Hewitt as, you're our stylist, he says. He has his eye on the offbeat. He writes like a dream. And another thing is, you're not interested so much in doing the president or doing the movie star, right? You sort of like the slant off.
You're right. I really don't care what movie stars have to say about life, unless there's a rule, I think, that I apply, that I think we should apply, is the person has to be more interesting or more compelling than what they do. And that's rare in life, among any of us.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And every once in a while, you meet someone like that, and I think Jackie Gleason, to me, was one of those guys, as brilliant as he was.
He was much more than...
He was this wonderful, over-the-top, hyperthyroid character that we don't see many of.
Great man. Morley Safer is our guest, the co-editor of 60 Minutes. He's here for the full hour. We'll be taking your calls later. We'll talk about current items in the news. We'll talk about his experiences as a Vietnam correspondent. Don't go away.
I came to this city. I was so shy that I never went to a restaurant. I don't go to a restaurant now.
But you're not that shy anymore.
In a different way.
You don't still go to restaurants.
I still don't go to restaurants because they charge $60 a meal. And I can serve you here anytime you want to come. You give me the $60 and I'll give you dinner.
What'd you think of her?
She was is a remarkable woman. She was like a taut wire.
Don't pull it too hard.
And utterly focused. You didn't ask stupid questions. You don't ask stupid questions of,
no,
or even silly questions or even casual questions. when I did that interview with her, the only ground rule was to not discuss Spencer Tracy. Spencer Tracy's widow was still alive, and she
respected that.
To not deal with that. But upstairs in the house on the east side of New York, there was a study in a little library that were just filled with memorabilia of that family, that unofficial family.
Morley Safer is the guest. Okay, let's get to some things in the news. How's President Bush doing?
I think he's doing remarkably well. Although I've heard people say the Republicans wish Clinton would go away, I think as long as Clinton stays around, Bush will continue to do extremely well. And he's been very, very clever by not commenting on any of these allegations of sleaze, et cetera, that we've all heard. What's interesting to me is that, with possibly a few controversial exceptions, the Bush cabinet is quite interesting. There are no flashy people in there, no stars, they all seem quite focused and serious and knowledgeable about the areas to which they've been appointed.
What do you make of going over to the Democrats' meetings and goes to West?
Well, I think he's reflecting what the election result or non-result, however you look at it, and it's very clever. How effective it's going to be, I don't know, but it's always disarming to treat with the enemy, so to speak. And I think the Democrats who don't know quite how to deal with it, they will.
You didn't they work will. Election night.
No,
what did you think of it?
It's not my thing.
What did you think of it?
What do I think of the coverage, or what do I...
Coverage.
I think everybody learned a lesson about rushing to judgment. I think there's it doesn't matter a damn to me whether CNN gives it at 11:01 and CBS at 10:59. Who really cares? How important is that? I mean, it's only important if you're making book, I suppose. I don't know. But I've never really quite understood that. I could understand the difference between an hour, but minutes or seconds? Come on. Does it make Dan Rather any better or Tom Brokaw any worse if one slipped past the other on the second that the election result was delivered?
Think the public cares?
It's foolish. Of course not. Besides, we only watch one station one.
I know, usually, yeah.
At a time.
So what's it? We don't know. What do you make of this whole Clinton thing? First, the pardon.
This was, possibly the worst gaffe a man could make as he left on fairly high ground. And I think it has sullied his presidency, not just his leaving of it. I think it genuinely has sullied the presidency. And it strikes me that as brilliant a politician as Bill Clinton is, as magnetic a personality as he can be, there is one little screw loose somewhere in the sense of the decorous or indecorous thing to do. He's lacking one little sensibility somewhere, it strikes me, to not have asked that question. Mark Rich, I mean, the guy didn't do a day of time. He bought his way into citizenships. Is this the kind of man we want to pardon? Let's take another look at the list. I think that the fact that his own lawyer was making the entreaty for the pardon should have been another red flag for him. You know, sorry, Mr. Quinn, I can't consider this simply because you're representing it.
Our guest is Morley Safer. This is Larry King Live. Tomorrow night, Nancy Reagan. We'll be right back. A few more things on politics, then some reminiscing and your phone calls. It's an hour with Morley Safer tonight of 60 Minutes. What do you make on the other side of the Clinton thing, the gift things and the listings by Senator Clinton and the returning?
Again, that sense of that sensibility that's missing. I mean, within that family, I suppose, where as you and your wife may be sitting over the breakfast table and maybe planning to do something or whatever, and one of you is going to say, you know, maybe we shouldn't.
My wife, constantly.
How's it going to
look? You really want to do that?
Exactly. And somehow that seems to be missing. And I don't know if I'd call it a character flaw.
Flaw. We've always asked questions, why do smart people do stupid things? So you don't think it's that simplified, right? Just a smart person doing a stupid thing. You think there's an arrogance about it?
I think there's a certain entitlement for people who, as Maureen Dowd says, have been living in public housing all their lives. I think there is a kind of entitlement.
Bill Clinton has never been
arrogance.
Finances aren't his thing. Accumulation of wealth is not his bag, is it? I mean, he's never been a... It's often been said he wouldn't know his net worth.
Let me give you a small example. One would think, given the trials, some of the less attractive moments in his presidency, and particularly in his leaving of it, one would have thought that perhaps the first public appearance he made might have been at a Harvard or a Princeton, and perhaps the second one would be at some
hospital.
Good works gala for a charity. And the third one would be to a bunch of bankers for real dough. One would have thought that would have been, as I said, the decorous kind of transition to the private sector. He went right for the money.
Can you be a good person and have those flaws? I mean, can you be a good president and have those flaws?
Oh, you can be a great president and be ridden with flaws. Of course we know that. And I think that Bill Clinton will probably be remembered as a great president in terms, particularly in terms of political savvy, in redefining, restructuring his own party, making it no longer a party of even the middle left, but the middle leading right. Interesting. The Republicans learned well from Bill Clinton in this last election. So I think he was a brilliant strategist. There's no question. Is a brilliant strategist. But a man riddled with flaws, with flaws writ very large, by the way, as we see.
More with Morley Safer on this edition of Larry King Live right after this.
Al Jeter is in jail, no question about that. The question is, what happened? What put him there?
Did you ever hold up anyone?
No, sir. I never hold up anyone.
Did you ever steal anything?
No, sir.
What did you do with your time off when you weren't working?
Well, I was a member of the library club there in Greenville. I was on the softball team.
Dallas County prosecutors Ken Cardin and Randy Eisenberg say they are convinced he is guilty. They told the jury that Jeter was an outlaw, known to the police. Those people who knew Jeter, his business associates at E-Systems, do not believe he could have done something like this. They insist he is innocent.
3 days after that broadcast, that young man, Linnell Jeter, was freed. He was wrongly convicted and sentenced to life in Texas prison. How did you feel?
Wonderful. We went into that story with a lot of questions about his conviction and a lot of questions about the severity of the sentence, which was a life sentence for, I think it was an alleged $50 holdup at a Kentucky Fried Chicken joint. And the more we dug into it, and the more evidence we found that neither the prosecution nor the defense even bothered with, the more it came clear that there was no way he could have done it. There is absolutely no way he could have done it. And with great anger and with great reluctance, the state of Texas saw the light, or the Attorney General of Texas saw the light a couple of days after.
Do you think there are a lot of boys like that in prison tonight?
A lot. I don't know.
There'll be some.
Some, for sure. One of the real tragic moments of that was when I, tragedy averted, of course, but was when you looked at the defense that his lawyer put up. It was appalling. Because his lawyer wanted a plea bargain. You know, you're a black guy. You probably held it up. Let's cop a plea. No way he would. He was a bright young engineer working at E-Systems in Texas. The great thing about that story, I am not in this business as a calling, Larry. I mean, I don't do what I do to right any wrongs. Having said that, the feeling of having changed a life, of having been part of changing a life, saving a life in a certain way.
Can't beat that.
Cannot beat it.
Our guest is Morley Safer. Tomorrow night, Nancy Reagan, a very special guest on Wednesday night. We'll announce it tomorrow morning on CNN. This is Larry King Live. Great to have Morley with us. We'll be back. We'll talk about covering war. And we'll take your phone calls as well.
This is what the war in Vietnam is all about. The old and the very young. The Marines have burned this old couple's cottage because fire was coming from here.
You been in action like this before, Marie?
No, I haven't. Not like this, I haven't.
Did you set fire to these houses here?
No, we were just off to the left of it when it was burning.
Were you getting fire from them?
Somewhat, not too much. Just a little sniper fire.
That's Morley Safer with some brilliant reportage in Vietnam. You were there? How long?
I did three tours, I guess, a total of about almost 2 years.
Some people like war corresponding. They like it. They hope there's some action they can go to. Mm-hmm. Were you one of those?
I think that in when you're in the middle of it, there is a certain rush of getting a great story, of being in combat, the adrenaline, that wonderful feeling of still being alive afterwards. But I must confess, I grew, after four or five different wars, I grew weary of that work. Partly because in an open war, open to coverage as Vietnam was, it's not that difficult, really. It really isn't.
Not hard to cover a war?
Physically can be very, very demanding. Your ingenuity is sometimes taxed because you have the story now, how do you get it out? That's not an issue anymore in the electronic world we live in. But beyond that, it is limited. It has massive limitations if you're intellectually curious, if you're interested in a lot of things.
How about being around killing?
Killing is the payoff of war.
I know, but being around it.
Being around it is, I've seen enough to satisfy more than a lifetime.
You've seen men kill?
Yes. And one feels terrible for the obvious reasons of seeing anyone killed, but even worse because of the voyeuristic nature. That's what you're there for, to
cover the killing.
To watch it.
Wouldn't want to do it again? Forget age.
What age?
Well, he's 69. They wouldn't have sent a 69-year-old to a cover.
If it was a pretty good story, I think I would. Sure, why not? I mean, instincts are still alive and well. Thank you very much.
Let's include some phone calls for Morley Safer. Evansville, Indiana. Hello.
Larry, enjoy your show. You got a great professional. My question is the legacy of Bill Clinton. What would historians say, let's say, 50 years from now? And I'm asking him this question. What will they say about the legacy of Bill Clinton? Was it good, was it bad, or a combination?
Hardest thing to predict. If you had asked about Truman in 52, they would have said terrible.
I think the legacy will largely be in changing the nature of the party, in changing the focus of the party, in changing the ideology of the party, in fact getting rid of ideology altogether, which is more or less what happened. And happened here, then happened in Britain in much the same way in terms of left and center parties. I think that he will probably be considered, a great architect of the party, superb politician, no question, but a man with clear and obvious faults.
So what we know now, 50 years ain't going to change much.
No, I don't think 50 years will change much. I don't think there are any more revelations, but who knows, in terms of the character issues.
You know, of what could come. What do you expect, by the way, in Israel tomorrow?
I expect that Sharon will win and that will make an awful lot of it. There's something going on there that just doesn't fit when you think about it, that Shimon Peres, who's perhaps one of the smartest men in the country, would have had the same kind of lead over Sharon that Sharon has over Barack.
So why isn't he running?
So why isn't he running, and why are the Israelis turning to Sharon? I suspect that he'll win, but not by the kind of lead that the pollsters have been suggesting. And I suspect that in terms of on the Palestinian side, the people who are running things, who are in the street, not in Arafat's office, are pleased with Sharon result because it keeps the issue sharp, in the sharp kind of focus that they want to maintain.
What story are you working on now?
I've just finished a story in Belgium that's really quite interesting on how mental patients are treated in Belgium.
And now, what led you to cover? I mean, if 60 Minutes, Don, you, it fascinates me. I got an idea for a story. Let's do a story on how mental patients are treated in Belgium.
Not quite how it works.
Somebody says to
John Hewitt, there's this town in Belgium that has really interesting way, and
you hear about it.
Yeah, and then Don may yawn at the idea, which he often does. But the great thing about Don, he has confidence in me and Mike and Ed and Leslie and Steve. That we're not going to go out and do stories that will put people to sleep.
Can I ask you just basically what they do in Belgium that they don't do anywhere else?
It's a foster care system. You don't see any homeless people in this area where we did the story. People have and for generations, have been taking mental patients
into their home.
Not dangerous people, mm-hmm. not pedophiles, not that kind of thing. As almost as, and they become members of the family. And it's a remarkable thing to see.
And they've been doing this for generations?
For generations, for centuries, actually.
In
this area, and it's now spread to other towns. It's a town called Gila, which is a pokey little town, not much.
So people are raised in the culture of this is what we do.
That's right, and when someone's in the family, with the family, the people who took that patient in get old and die. The children of those people then assume the responsibility for that patient or those patients.
You got a good job. We'll be back with more of Morley Safer, more of your phone calls. Don't go away. We're back with Morley Safer of 60 Minutes, Sayville, New York. Hello.
Hi, Mr. Safer. My question is, in light of the advent of all the TV magazine shows, has the competition led 60 Minutes to do less newsy, more glitzy stories?
I don't think so. I think if you look at our work over the last five, 6 years, 10 years since this competition has increased, I think what we all of us realize that what the competition does is maintain it keeps our distinction. It makes us obviously different from 2020 or Dateline.
The more tabloidish they get, the better off you are.
Well, yes. I think the more reason for people to come back to us, if they ever left, I don't know. There's no question. I think that we are distinct in that respect. And the fact that we don't have the bells and whistles, and we don't have the music, and we don't have
But you
have
did a lot of running down the street with microphones, chasing people.
Mr. Wallace's specialty, please, sir.
The chaser.
I did a few of those. There was that brief period.
You never did an O.J. Simpson story, right?
No, we didn't. Steve did one about a juror.
Afterwards,
yeah. No, we didn't. There is some, I guess, some feeling in the broadcast by some about the importance of these so-called gets, which a word I detest.
But it's a good word, isn't it? There are people you want to get.
But once you get, what you got?
Once you get the get,
what you got. What you got?
Then you got to think, who's the next get to get?
Well, and the only thing you have is that you have them, and they're generally turn out to be not that interesting or compelling. There are plenty, I'm sure, I know who are. But for the most part, so what?
Asheville, North Carolina for Morley Safer. Hello.
Morley, how do you compare Clinton's controversial pardon to Ford's pardon of Nixon and Bush's pardon of the Iran-Contra participants?
Caspar Weinberger and others.
I think in many ways, when Jerry Ford pardon Nixon, he in a certain way he did speak for the country. And about
a long national nightmare.
A long national nightmare. And I think an awful lot of people, even Ford's political enemies, said it's time to get on I think the Bush pardon of Iran-Contra was defensible in a certain sense, to the extent that there is that, whatever you want to call it, bond within an administration. Clinton's pardoning of Mark Rich was off the wall. I think too many, many people seemed off the wall. A man who'd not done any time, who had the resources to defy the American legal system and the FBI and the local police here in New York and the Department of Justice. And had the resources to become a citizen of practically wherever he wanted to become a citizen of. To pardon someone like that just seems beyond rationality.
Well said. We'll be back with more of Morley Safer, Nancy Reagan, tomorrow night. Don't go away. Albuquerque, New Mexico, for Morley Safer. Hello.
Hello, Mr. Safer. My question is, have you ever been pressured to not run a story?
Have I? I have not. And as far as the broadcast is concerned,
must have been attempts.
There was the tobacco issue, which I wasn't part of, and I'm not going to get into that.
The famous story. Informer movie.
No, and whenever it's suggested that somehow our sponsors have some kind of influence or control of what we do cover or what we don't cover in some kind of censorship through financial pressure is rubbish, because that's never happened. And a lot of sponsors over the years have left us. They've all come back, but they chose to leave us for a while because of stories we've done about them or their products or their friends' products or whatever. So there never has been this kind of pressure. And all of us who work in the broadcast are really quite proud of it. As I say, there was this lapse. But that wasn't so much a sponsor. That was not at all a sponsor, in fact. There were other issues involved.
Akron, Ohio, hello.
Hi, Mr. Safer. My question is, what is your worst interview and your best interview?
You have a worst?
Probably a pocket full of worst. There was an interview I did with someone who was very important in British intelligence in World War II. And I had just gotten off the plane, and he was a very tedious man, and I fell asleep. I fell asleep in the interview. And the cameraman, who was a very good friend of mine, John Tiffin, and the camera was over this shoulder, and you're this guy. And at one point, my head went down against the lens, and John reached around and grabbed me by the hair, and just...
That's a great story.
He was a tedious man.
Yes. How did the guest react?
The guest didn't notice. He was so in love with what he was saying. And he had insisted that I have whiskey with him before we sat down for the interview. And I had just gotten off the plane. I was jet lagged. So that didn't help.
We'll be back with our remaining moments with the wonderful Morley Safer of CBS. Don't go away. Morley Safer still uses a manual typewriter. Des Moines, Iowa. Hello.
Hello there. When you're reporting on a controversial issue over which you have very strong feelings, how do you keep your feelings out of the reporting, or do you?
Well, it's what you do for a living, and I think one does keep one's feelings out of. To lose at least some degree of your object, some degree of
objectivity. Can't be 100% objective.
Well, of course not.
Blocked.
I mean, it makes no sense. No one is. But I think that when you do it long enough, you know how to do it. Some people that you sit and talk to, you have to grit your teeth in order to stay in the same room as them, but you get on with it and ask the questions that you assume most of the people watching want to ask.
We had a great night here when we had the whole cast of you on. Who could ever forget that, with Andy and Don and the whole group. Do you get along that well, as it appeared that night? Is it a very convivial group?
It's pretty good now. Back in the old days, 20-odd years ago, Mike and I were occasionally like scorpions in a bottle.
Really?
Oh, yeah. But I think those days are gone forever, although you never know with Wallace.
Is this a maturity or?
Mike, mature, forget it.
You know, what is Mike's story? I mean, what is
his real age?
He takes Dick Clark pills, right? I mean, what?
I don't. He's remarkable. You know, I maintain, what's interesting about Mike is the herald of what's to come. I mean, in terms of the country has to start thinking about of a workforce into its 60s, 70s, 80s, or even 90s. And by the middle of this century, that's going to be the case. And what are they going to do with these old people who are still at the height of their strength? It's going to be interesting. Society's not ready for it.
And he doesn't lose an inch. I mean,
it's rather unfortunate.
No, I don't mean it. Safer, I don't want to go where your mind is. He doesn't, I mean, he's the faculties, the.
No, he's got it. He has.
Even the voice, there's no diminishment.
No, he really is. I mean, Mike is, as I say, the herald, the exemplar of what society should be thinking about in terms of how do you deal with a society in which a good part of your workforce refuses to retire or die.
You're not hinting that about
No.
Thank you, Morley. Always great. Morley Safer, co-editor, 60 Minutes, CBS News correspondent. Sit while I say goodnight. Look, he's jumping off the set. Only been in the business 72 years, and he's looking around like, where is there a monitor?